Hello dear students, in the third part of the topic of sexual reproduction in flowering plants under the unit reproduction, we will cover the process of pollination and its kinds, pollen-pistil interaction and artificial hybridization. In the second part of this chapter, we have already discussed the structure and development of the megasporangium or the ovule and the embryo sac along with its types in detail. We close the second episode with a point to think about. Let us discuss it first. The point was which part of the gynecium develop into fruit and seeds. The answer is from the gynecium the ovary develops into fruit and ovules develop into seeds. So dear students, now let us start with the next part of the topic, sexual reproduction in plants. First of all, let us discuss about pollination. We have already learnt that the male and female gametes in flowering plants are produced in the pollen grain and embryo sac respectively. As both types of gametes are non-motile, they have to be brought together for fertilization. A question arises that how is this achieved? The answer is pollination. Pollination is the mechanism to achieve this objective. Transfer of pollen grains when they shed from the anther to the stigma of a pistil is termed pollination. Flowering plants have evolved an amazing array of adaptations to achieve pollination. They make use of external agents to achieve pollination. Let us see some of these types. Depending on the source of pollen, pollination can be divided into three types. The first type is autogamy. In this type, pollination is achieved within the same flower. Transfer of pollen grains take place from the anther to the stigma of the same flower. Here we can see an example of the self-pollinated flower. In a normal flower which opens and exposes the anthers and the stigma, complete autogamy is rare. Autogamy in such flowers require synchrony in pollen release and stigma receptivity, and also the anthers and the stigma should lie close to each other so that self-pollination can occur. Some plants such as viola or common pansy, oxalis and camelina produce two types of flowers. They are chasmogamous flowers and cleistogamous flowers. In this diagram, we can observe the cleistogamous and chasmogamous flowers. The chasmogamous flowers are similar to flowers of other species with exposed anthers and stigma. On the other hand, cleistogamous flowers do not open at all. In such flowers, the anthers and stigma lie close to each other. When anthers dehisce in the flower buds, pollen grains come in contact with the stigma to effect pollination. Thus, cleistogamous flowers are invariably autogamous as there is no chance of cross-pollination landing on the stigma. Cleistogamous flowers produce assured seed set even in the absence of pollinators. Now, let us see the second kind of pollination. This is gitonogamy. Here, transfer of pollen grains from the anther to the stigma of other flower of the same plant happens. Although gitonogamy is functionally cross-pollination involving a pollinating agent, genetically it is similar to autogamy since the pollen grains come from the same plant. Now let us see the third kind of pollination. It is xenogamy. Here, transfer of pollen grains from anther to the stigma of a different plant happens. This is the only type of pollination which during pollination brings genetically different types of pollen grains to the stigma. We can observe a cross-pollinated flower in this photograph. Now let us discuss the agents of pollination. Plants use wind and water as abiotic and animals as biotic agents to achieve pollination. Majority of plants use biotic agents for pollination. Only a small proportion of plants use abiotic agents. Pollen grains coming in contact with the stigma is a chance factor in both wind and water pollination. To compensate for these uncertainties and associated loss of pollen grains, the flower produces enormous amount of pollen when compared to the number of ovules available for pollination. Pollination by wind is more common among abiotic pollinations. Wind pollination also requires that the pollen grains are light and non-sticky so that they can be transported in wind currents. They often possess well-exposed stamens so that the pollens are easily dispersed into wind currents, and large, often feathery stigma to easily trap airborne pollen grains. Here in this diagram, we can observe a wind-pollinated plant showing compact inflorescence and well-exposed stamens. Wind-pollinated flowers often have a single ovule in each ovary and numerous flowers packed into an inflorescence. A familiar example is the corn cob. The tassels you see are nothing but the stigma and style which wave in the wind to trap pollen grains. Wind pollination is quite common in grasses. Pollination by water is quite rare in flowering plants and is limited to about 30 genera, mostly monocotyledons. As against this, you would recall that water is a regular mode of transport for the male gametes among the lower plant groups, such as algae, bryophytes and pteridophytes. It is believed, particularly for some bryophytes and pteridophytes, that their distribution is limited because of the need for water for the transport of male gametes and fertilization. Some examples of water-pollinated plants are vallisneria and hydrilla, which grow in fresh water, and several marine sea grasses such as zostera. It is important to know that all aquatic plants do not use water for pollination. In a majority of aquatic plants, such as water hyacinth and water lily, the flowers emerge above the level of water and are pollinated by insects or wind, as in most of the land plants. In vallisneria, the female flower reaches the surface of water by the long stalk, and the male flowers or pollen grains are released onto the surface of water. They are carried passively by water currents. Some of them eventually reach the female flower and the stigma. We can observe pollination by water in vallisneria in this diagram. In another group of water pollinated plants, such as sea grasses, female flowers remain submerged in water and the pollen grains are released inside the water. Pollen grains in many such species are long, ribbon-like, and they are carried passively inside the water. Some of them reach the stigma and achieve pollination. In most of the water pollinated species, pollen grains are protected from wetting by a mucilaginous covering. Both wind and water pollinated flowers are not very colorful and do not produce nectar. Majority of flowering plants use a range of animals as pollinating agents: bees, butterflies, flies, beetles, wasps, ants, moths, birds like sunbirds and hummingbirds, and bats are the common pollinating agents. Here in this photograph, we can observe an insect pollinating a flower. Among the animals, insects, particularly bees, are the dominant biotic pollinating agents. Even larger animals such as some primates like lemurs, arboreal or tree-dwelling rodents, or even reptiles like gecko lizard and garden lizard have also been reported as pollinators in some species. Often flowers of animal pollinated plants are specifically adapted for a particular species of animal. Majority of insect pollinated flowers are large, colorful, fragrant and rich in nectar. When the flowers are small, a number of flowers are clustered into an inflorescence to make them conspicuous. Animals are attracted to flowers by color or fragrance or both. The flowers pollinated by flies and beetles secrete foul odors to attract these animals. To sustain animal visits, the flowers have to provide rewards to the animals. Nectar and pollen grains are the useful floral rewards. For harvesting the rewards from the flower, the animal visitor comes in contact with the anthers and the stigma. The body of the animal gets a coating of pollen grains, which are generally sticky in animal pollinated flowers. When the animal carrying pollen on its body comes in contact with the stigma, it brings about pollination. In some species, floral rewards are in providing safe place to lay eggs. For example, the tallest flower of Amorphophallus, the flower itself is about 6 feet in height. A similar relationship exists between a species of moth and the plant yucca, where both species, moth and the plant, cannot complete their life cycles without each other. The moth deposits its eggs in the locule of the ovary, and the flower in turn gets pollinated by the moth. The larva of the moth comes out of the eggs as the seed starts developing. Students, you can observe some flowers of the flowering plants or any other available to you, like cucumber, mango, peepal, coriander, papaya, onion, lobia, cotton, tobacco, rose, lemon, eucalyptus, banana, etc. Try to find out which animals visit them and whether they could be pollinators. You will have to patiently observe the flowers over a few days and at different times of the day. You could also try to see whether there is any correlation in the characteristics of a flower to the animal that visits it. Carefully observe if any of the visitors come in contact with the anthers and the stigma, as only such visitors can bring about pollination. Many insects may consume pollen or the nectar without bringing about pollination. Such floral visitors are referred to as pollen or nectar robbers. Students, now let us discuss outbreeding devices. Majority of flowering plants produce hermaphrodite flowers, and pollen grains are likely to come in contact with the stigma of the same flower. Continued self-pollination result in inbreeding depression. Flowering plants have developed many devices to discourage self-pollination and to encourage cross-pollination. In some species, pollen release and stigma receptivity are not synchronized. Either the pollen is released before the stigma becomes receptive, or stigma becomes receptive much before the release of pollen. In some other species, the anther and stigma are placed at different positions so that the pollen cannot come in contact with the stigma of the same flower. Both these devices prevent autogamy. The third device to prevent inbreeding is self-incompatibility. This is a genetic mechanism and prevents self-pollen, which means pollen from the same flower or other flowers of the same plant, from fertilizing the ovules by inhibiting pollen germination or pollen tube growth in the pistil. Another device to prevent self-pollination is the production of unisexual flowers. If both male and female flowers are present on the same plant, such as castor and maize, which is monoecious, it prevents autogamy, but not gitanogamy. In several species, such as papaya, male and female flowers are present on different plants. That is, each plant is either male or female. This condition prevents both autogamy and gitanogamy. Students, let us discuss that what is pollen-pistil interaction. Pollination does not guarantee the transfer of the right type of pollen. Often, pollen of the wrong type, either from other species or self-incompatible pollen from the same plant, also land on the stigma. The pistil has the ability to recognize the pollen, whether it is the right type or compatible, or the wrong type or incompatible. If it is of the right type, the pistil accepts the pollen and promotes post-pollination events that leads to fertilization. If the pollen is of the wrong type, the pistil rejects the pollen by preventing pollen germination on the stigma or the pollen tube growth in the style. The ability of the pistil to recognize the pollen followed by its acceptance or rejection is the result of continuous dialogue between pollen grain and the pistil. This dialogue is mediated by chemical components of the pollen interacting with those of the pistil. It is only in recent years that botanists have been able to identify some of the pollen and pistil components and the interactions leading to the recognition followed by acceptance or rejection. As mentioned earlier, following compatible pollination, the pollen grain germinates on the stigma to produce a pollen tube through one of the germ pores. In this diagram, we can observe the pollen grains germinating on the stigma. The contents of the pollen grain move into the pollen tube. Pollen tube grows through the tissue of stigma and style and reaches the ovary. We can observe the pollen tubes growing through the style in this diagram. The next diagram shows the longitudinal section of pistil showing the path of the pollen tube growth. Students, you would recall that in some plants, pollen grains are shed at two-celled condition with a vegetative cell and a generative cell. In such plants, the generative cell divides and forms the two male gametes during the growth of pollen tube in the stigma. In plants which shed pollen in the three-celled condition, pollen tubes carry the two male gametes from the beginning. Pollen tube, after reaching the ovary, enters the ovule through the micropyle and then enters one of the synergids through the filiform apparatus. In this diagram, you can observe an enlarged view of an egg apparatus showing entry of pollen tube into a synergid. The next diagram shows discharge of male gametes into a synergid and the movements of the sperms, one into the egg and the other into the central cell. Many recent studies have shown that filiform apparatus present at the micropylar part of the synergids guide the entry of pollen tube. All these events, from pollen deposition on the stigma until pollen tubes enter the ovule, are together referred as pollen-pistil interaction. As pointed out earlier, pollen-pistil interaction is a dynamic process involving pollen recognition followed by promotion or inhibition of the pollen. The knowledge gained in this area would help the plant breeders in manipulating pollen-pistil interaction, even in incompatible pollinations, to get desired hybrids. It is important to know that a plant breeder is interested in crossing different species and often genera to combine desirable characters to produce commercially superior varieties. Dear students, we are now reached at the last point of this part of this lecture, which is artificial hybridization. Artificial hybridization is one of the major approaches of crop improvement programs. In such crossing experiments, it is important to make sure that only the desired pollen grains are used for pollination and the stigma is protected from contamination, from unwanted pollen. This is achieved by emasculation and bagging techniques. If the female parent bears bisexual flowers, removal of anthers from the flower buds before the anther dehisces using a pair of forceps is necessary. This step is referred to as emasculation. Emasculated flowers have to be covered with a bag of suitable size, generally made up of butter paper, to prevent contamination of its stigma with unwanted pollen. This process is called bagging. When the stigma of bagged flower attains receptivity, mature pollen grains collected from anthers of the male parent are dusted on the stigma and the flowers are rebagged and the fruits are allowed to develop. If the female parent produces unisexual flowers, there is no need for emasculation. The female flower buds are bagged before the flower open. When the stigma becomes receptive, pollination is carried out using the desired pollen and the flower rebagged. So, students, with this we have come to an end of the third part of this lesson on sexual reproduction of flowering plants. Here we have discussed the process of pollination and its kinds, pollen-pistil interaction and artificial hybridization. In the next episode, we will focus on double fertilization and post-fertilization structures and events like endosperm and embryo development, formation of seeds in the fruits, parthenocarpic fruits and the process of apomixis and polyembryony. The point for thinking for this part of the lesson is, what is viviparity in plants? We will discuss this point in the next part of the program. With this, I conclude this episode. Thank you.